In the last class, we have seen about some of the methods followed by farmers to ensure maximum diversity in agriculture. And we have seen about intercropping method and crop rotation. Now, today we are moving to next topic, crop management. Look at the thoughts of a farmer about improving yield. Now, here the thoughts of a farmer about improving yield is given. What are his thoughts? There should be no weeds. Weedicides can be used. There should be no disease or pest. Pesticides should be sprayed. There should be no fall in the yield. Chemical fertilizers should be added well. So these are the thoughts of that farmer. Now, using pesticides and chemical fertilizers have both advantages and disadvantages. Now, even though these pesticides helps to remove the pest, it has so many disadvantages. Same like that, chemical fertilizers also help to improve the yield, but it has so many disadvantages. So first, let us see what are the harmful effects of using pesticides and chemical fertilizers. Now let's see what are the harmful effects of using pesticides. Pesticides can cause short-term adverse health effects called acute effects, as well as chronic adverse effects that can occur months or years after exposure. Examples of acute health effects including stinging eyes, rashes, blisters, blindness, nausea, dizziness, diarrhea, and death. So these are some of the harmful effects of using pesticides. So it has both short-term and chronic adverse effects, which may occur after so many months or after some years. Okay, so use of pesticides causes all these problems. Now coming to fertilizers. Fertilizers may cause respiratory ailments, cardiac disease, and several cancers, as well as can inhibit crop growth, increase allergenic pollen production. So, same like pesticides, these fertilizers also can cause respiratory problems or cardiac diseases and several cancers. Excess nitrogen used in crop fertilization can contribute to the release of greenhouse gases such as carbon dioxide and nitrous oxide in the atmosphere. So, use of these fertilizers may cause diseases, and also it may release more gases like nitrous oxide to the atmosphere. Okay, so these are some of the harmful effects caused by pesticides and chemical fertilizers. Now, are the decisions of the farmer beneficial? What kind of decisions should the farmer take? Shouldn't we promote the use of fertilizers and pesticides that are not harmful to nature? Examine the information given below. So, we have to think about the use of pesticides and chemical fertilizers. Now, shouldn't we promote the use of fertilizers and pesticides which are not harmful to nature? Now, let's see the box what Fukuoka says. For man's survival, we should return to nature. It is man who is destroying forest, the springs and fertility of the earth. Such environmental destruction should be stopped if all living organisms, including man, are to be saved. Biofertilizers are an excellent to the soil, deadened by the use of chemical fertilizers. They catalyze life and retain the fertility of the soil. Our aim should be to make land cultivable rather than a desert. So, Our aim should be to make land which is good for cultivation. So for that, we should use biopesticides and biofertilizers which are not harmful to the nature. Now let's see what are biopesticides. That first one is tobacco decoction. Cut 1 kg tobacco into small pieces. Soak them in 15 liters of water for 1 day. Filter this and dissolve 100 grams crepe bar soap in it by stirring well. Tobacco pesticide is ready. Dilute this by adding double the quantity of water and then spray on plants. So we can make ourselves a biopesticides using tobacco, bar soap and water. Okay, now next one is neem cake. Adding neem cake, castor cake, etc. to the soil helps to control worms that attack roots. So like tobacco, another one is neem cake, which we can add to the soil and it helps to control the worms that attack roots. Next one, neem oil emulsion. Dissolve 60 gram soap in 1/2 liter water. Mix it with 1 liter of neem oil and stir well. Dilute it with 10 liter water and spray on plants. So this is another one biopesticide. These all we can make ourselves and these all are not harmful to the nature. And we can spray on the plants. Okay, so these are the 3 biopesticides which we can use on plants. Now next we'll see biofertilizers. Now biofertilizers include cow dung, green manure, compost manure, fish manure, poultry droppings, goat droppings and bone meal. So these biofertilizers are easily available for us. Now this cow dung, green manure, compost manure, fish manure, all these does not affect the soil. Okay, and these help to retain the fertility of the soil. So all these promotes the growth of the plant. Now here is an activity. Discuss the importance of making it a habit to use biofertilizers and biopesticides. Prepare biopesticides and apply it in the school vegetable garden. Record the method of their preparation, materials used, and the mode of application in your science diary. Conduct a seminar on this topic and present your ideas. So, we all should make it a habit to use biofertilizers and biopesticides so that there will be no harmful effects both on humans and also for the nature. Okay, so this is about biopesticides and biofertilizers. Now, do we cultivate only food crops? Which other crops do we cultivate? So, we cultivate variety of crops, not only food crops, so many other crops are also there. So in that, let us see some crops. First one is cotton. Cotton is an important fiber crop cultivated in India. The cotton and the seeds are separated from mature cotton balls. Thread is obtained from cotton. Cotton seed is used as cattle feed. The oil obtained from cotton seeds is used for industrial purposes. So, one of the main fiber crop cultivated in India is cotton. And this thread is obtained from cotton, which we use for our clothes. And the seed is used as cattle feed. And the oil, which is obtained from cotton seeds, is used for industrial purposes. Okay. Next one is jute. India is the largest producer of jute in the world. Jute fiber is obtained from the stem of jute plant. Jute sheaves are first soaked in water for retting. They are then beaten to separate the fibers. Sack thread is made of jute fiber. So what is jute? Have you seen this jute? Now have you seen the rice bags or rice sacks? That sacks in which rice is stored is made up of jute. Okay. Next one is coir. Coconut husk is soaked in water. This is beaten to separate fibers. These fibers are woven to make different types of coir products. Now, coconut husk that is soaked in water and it is beaten to separate fibers. And that fibers is woven to different types of coir products. We can see mats and also bags also. So like that, we can make so many products with this coir. From now onwards, when we buy things like doormats, I will ask my father to buy those made of coir. Isn't it of natural origin? So these all are natural products that we obtained from nature. Okay, so these are some of the other crops which we are cultivating in our country. Now next, integrated farming. What is integrated farming? Integrated farming is the method of integrating more than one field of agriculture. Okay, so in this picture you can see different methods of agriculture or different agricultural methods are integrated together. Okay, now let's see what are the products we obtained from this integrated farming. Now in this integrated farming methods, the products formed are rice, vegetables, fruits, egg, meat, straw, slurry, biogas, dung, vermi compost. So you can see in the picture how those agriculture methods are related or integrated together. What all fields of agriculture are integrated? Cattle rearing, vegetable farming, paddy cultivation and poultry. In the picture it is shown that so different fields are integrated there. They are cattle rearing, vegetable farming, paddy cultivation and poultry. Now how is the organic waste managed? The straw obtained from paddy cultivation and the bran obtained from husking paddy grains can be given to cattle as fodder. So the straw which we obtain after the paddy cultivation and the bran which you obtain from husking paddy grains, these both can be given to cattle as fodder. Organic waste produced in home, agriculture and cattle rearing are used for preparation of biogas, and the remaining organic waste that produced in home, agriculture and cattle rearing is used for preparation of biogas and vermi compost. Now how do farmers find food for birds and animals? The straw obtained from paddy cultivation, the bran obtained from husking paddy can be given to cattle and birds as fodder. The leftover food from home can be used for poultry. So these are the different types of agricultural fields which are integrated and we can obtain so many products and also animals, birds, all obtain their food from this type of farming. Okay. Note the advantage of placing the duck coop above the fish pond. Now just see the picture there. What is the advantage of placing the duck coop above the fish pond? In the picture, a fish pond is shown, and above the fish pond, a duck coop is placed. The leftover food of the duck will be available to the fish. So, what is the advantage of keeping like this? That is, the leftover food of the duck will be available to the fish. Moreover, droppings of ducks will promote the growth of aquatic plants. So, the droppings of these ducks will promote the growth of aquatic plants. And these aquatic plants are food for fish. At the same time, insects, algae, snail, and small frogs in the ponds will become food for the ducks. And one another advantage is the insects, algae, and the snail and the frogs in the pond will become the food for ducks. So, both these are interrelated. Both have benefits with this. Okay, so that is the advantage of placing duck coop above the fish pond. So both the fish and the duck obtain their food. Okay. Agriculture and cattle rearing. Agriculture and cattle rearing are integrated farming methods in Kerala that existed traditionally. We know that in Kerala, agriculture and cattle rearing are integrated farming methods. Now in this, cows and buffaloes can be reared along with paddy cultivation. And we know that before paddy cultivation, these cows and buffaloes are reared along with paddy cultivation. Fodder grass can be cultivated in coconut fields and rubber plantations. The straw obtained from paddy cultivation, the bran obtained from husking paddy grains, etc., can be given to cattle as fodder. So, as we told before, the straw obtained from the paddy cultivation can be given to cattle as fodder. Okay, so this is about integrated farming method. Now find out other similar possibilities. Write in your science diary how the areas are related to one another. Prepare an agriculture album collecting news, reports, pictures, etc. So this is an activity for you. So, and write it in your science diary. How the areas are related to one another. Okay.